The last time I paid with cash probably was over a year, 2 years ago.
I think I had to do some laundry, so I had to get quarters.
Probably 3 months.
And to get quarters, I had to go to the ATM and exchange it for more quarters.
For some reason, I still believe that people would still be using cash because I use cash.
But I feel like most young people don't have cash on them, so it gets hard when you're trying to pay people or split the bill.
I don't think the wallet is dead. I think that the use is changing.
The last time I carried my wallet around, I got it stolen.
In general, it's just there to kind of manage your electronic transactions and just has a bunch of other cards that I might need in some day in my life.
I think the future of money is definitely moving away from, you know, your physical wallet.
Towards an electronic space.
The future of money is this.
Everything in your wallet eventually ends up in your phone, on your watch.
Apps like Venmo or Apple Pay.
In the next 20 years, money is going to be completely electronic.
Paying each other over an app instead of physically in person.
You have the Apple Watch where you just click to pay. You have Venmo now where you can just transfer money on your phone. I think carrying around cash is becoming very outdated.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Michael Vaughn.
So I'm not actually on my phone. This is where I keep my notes. So in the spirit of the future of things, my notes are on my phone. So if I'm holding my phone, that's what I'm doing. So first, I want to thank everyone who put this event together. It's an amazing event, an amazing series. Thank you to President Owen and to Amelia and Matt and all the folks that put this together. We got here and I was like, whoa, this is a lot bigger than I realized. So, but it is an amazing series. I watched all of the other videos and humbled and honored to be part of it. And especially when you look at the other folks that you've had here. So great job with the series, really interesting and thoughtful program. So it's a great thing to be part of it. So a little bit about me. So I'm a startup guy. I'm a Philly guy. I went to a little school in West Philly. We used to call it not Penn State because people are like, oh, you go to Penn State. It's actually called Penn. I was a Wharton undergrad. I was a business major. I was into programming and things like that. I spent 5 years out in San Francisco. Right out of school, I started a business. We started it. We ran it, and then we ran it into the ground. So one of the things you'll learn in entrepreneurial management class is how much you can learn from your failures. So we got that out of the way right out of the gate. The first thing in my career was I failed miserably. I learned a ton of stuff. What I learned was I didn't want to have a real job at a real company ever again. So I went from that point, and you'll learn at Wharton, all anyone wants to do is go and work for Goldman Sachs or McKinsey. And we were kind of like the outcast. We were like, we're going to go do this startup thing. And people were like, why are you going to do that? You're supposed to go work at a bank or go work in consulting. But I learned very clearly at that point I needed to go build something and do something and create something. So spent 5 years out in San Francisco in the first dot-com boom in the late 90s, early 2000s with a company called Telefia. That was in the wireless space that eventually got acquired by Nielsen, which is sort of the Nielsen of Nielsen TV ratings. We used to pitch our company as, hey, we're like Nielsen TV ratings, but for wireless. And as it turns out, it became Nielsen Mobile. Moved back east after a few years. My wife and I had our first son out there. We decided we wanted to move back east. And we settled down back in Philly, joined a startup called Ticket Leap, which is in the ticketing space, sort of the Eventbrite, Ticketfly kind of thing. Still going, still moving along. That's where I met Ikram, and he became one of the founders of Venmo, which is part of the future of money. That's why I'm here today. Ikram started Venmo with his college roommate, Cortina, and he left Ticket Leap, did that. That was like 2009, 2010. When I left Ticket Leap, I joined them. And my claim to fame is I'm like the 10th user on Venmo. That's much bigger than the rest of my career. User ID, oh, I can't give you my user ID, that's secret. But on the 10th, I am the 10th user on Venmo. I was a user before I started working for them. So, and then that was 6 years ago, and so the rest of that is history. So that's me from then to now. Another thing is, I wanted to try to sort of figure out well, I didn't go to Northeastern, and you've had some other people that were alumni and tied into the school. We actually have so if you didn't know, Venmo is part of PayPal, and we have a bunch of other companies like Braintree and Zoom and Paydiant. Paydiant's a local company based in Newton, and we have a PayPal office in Boston. Between the Boston offices, we have 25 alumni working at one of the PayPal offices and Paydiant offices. We have 3 at Venmo that are software engineers at Venmo. We have 5 graduate and 2 undergraduate co-op, active co-op students today that have been part of it. Paydiant's been involved in that program for a while. And now I'm looking, how do we get plugged into that and get some of those folks down to New York and out to San Francisco? So we have really deep ties that I didn't even realize when I agreed to do this, which is awesome. And the program is amazing. The school is unbelievable in terms of what it's trying to do. I love the co-op program. We've been doing intern, sort of traditional summer intern programs quite a bit, but the co-op program is unbelievable. One interesting thing about the future of money, there's a bunch of research companies out there. I won't name this one, but there was a really big name research company at the end of 2014 that said they were doing a forecast of mobile payments for the next 5 years. So they're saying, what's going to happen over the next 5 years through 2019? And they made this really bold statement. They said, in 2019, the mobile P2P payments market, so P2P is what Venmo does, it's peer-to-peer, so friend-to-friend. And they said in 2019, the mobile P2P payments market, let me get the number right, is going to be $17 billion. Actually, I think they said 16. $17 billion in 2019. What did Venmo do in 2016? $17.6 billion. So in 2 years, we did what they thought was going to happen 5 years down the road just at Venmo. So the industry doesn't know what the future of money is. No one saw this coming. Venmo in Q4 2016, last quarter, we did $5.6 billion in P2P payments just in the US. And that's 125% year-over-year growth. It's growing on that number like crazy. No one, if I could go back to when I joined Ikram and Cortina, we were out raising money and we said, hey, what do you think about the idea of, like, I'm gonna send money to somebody and there's a social context to it, I'm gonna share the payment, and there's this thing where you can use it on your phone, and everyone said, you're nuts. Every single person we met with, except for a couple who wanted to put money into it, said we were nuts. Here we are, 2016, we did $17 billion in P2P payments that the industry thought wasn't gonna happen until 2019 across industry-wide. So we're seeing something happen that no one really quite understands. And when you hear everybody talking about mobile payments and Tap to Pay and Wave to Pay and FC codes and QR codes and all these other things, we think they're kind of focused on the wrong thing. We think that there's something else going on here that people don't quite understand. So I'll let you in on a little secret. The future of money, everybody get the recording ready, because this is the most important thing I'm going to say all day. The future of money, in a somewhat ironic turn of events, is not about money at all. So thank you. No. So what is it about? So the rest of the world, a lot of things going on. Weirdly, the US is actually behind on some of this evolution, as we all know. In Asia, there's a lot of apps that have payments baked in and messaging apps, and it's way ahead. Paying with your phone has been around and is adopted for a long time. Even in developing markets, ironically, they've leapfrogged all of this evolution of the industrial revolution and technology revolution, and M-Pesa is one of the biggest, if not the biggest, mobile payments platform in the world. And it's because it leapfrogged all that other technology and jumped on the wireless sort of revolution. And all of a sudden, they had a way to communicate. And that solved that problem. But in the US and other developed markets like the US and Europe, where you have banking infrastructure, you have a way to pay for things, you have a way to send money back and forth, you have a way to get at your cash, the real problem that we're trying to solve here is not about new technology. It could be technology, it could be driven by technology, but it's not about the technology itself. And I think that's where our industry has gotten stuck. When you look at all of the solutions that are trying to find problems, like tap to pay and QR codes and NFC and all of these other things, the future is about the experience. And it's not about technology, it's not about some existing problem, it's about how do you make a better experience? How do you make it easier to get at your money? How do you make it easier to use your money? How do you make it easier and less costly to access your money, spend your money, save your money? That's what we're thinking about, is how do you think about the experience overall and not a technology solution that's looking for a problem? And that's where Venmo lives. When I think about the future of money, it's about the experience and how do you enhance the experience. When you think about Venmo, the funny thing about it is we didn't invent a new technology. Everything that Venmo does was already happening. Banks did it, PayPal did it. There was a number of ways you could get money back and forth to each other. What we did was change the experience. We made it more delightful, we made it simpler, we made it more connected, we made it faster, all of those things. But it really wasn't new technology that did that. It was focused on what is the customer experience that we want to do and what are the problems with the existing experience. So what we're going to talk about, that's all I have to say in terms of canned remarks. So what we're going to talk about, I think, with questions, I want to hear from you what you want to learn about Venmo or about the industry, or if you care about what I've done. Happy to answer any of those questions. But the focus for what we do every day is think about what experience are we trying to solve? What problem are we trying to solve? Not what technology are we trying to invent? So with that, I'll open it up to questions.
Welcome, Mike. I have all my notes on both. You talked about the experience. And if you want to continue to focus on the experience with Venmo, what's next?
So with Venmo, if you use Venmo, you know, Venmo is primarily what we call peer-to-peer. And so it's friend to friend or colleague to colleague or family member to family member. And it's solving, we were thinking about how do we solve mostly about a cash problem, not like the other payment solutions were a problem, but what we replaced mostly is cash payments that or check payments or people paying each other back that was awkward or hard or difficult. What we hear from people most about Venmo is, I want to use it more. I want to use it with more people. So we get more people on the platform, that helps. But I want to use it in more ways. So how do I get the benefit of what I like about the Venmo experience and what I feel is so different about the Venmo experience? How do I get that in more ways and more opportunities? So when we think about what's next, it's how do we expand that use case? So we started doing things last year where we introduced a way for you to, our users to use Venmo to pay merchants inside their merchant app. So one of the companies, we got acquired by Braintree, which is the payment processor for a lot of the biggest and most popular mobile apps. And we started with them with a program last year where those merchants inside their app can create a Venmo button, essentially pull together the Venmo experience with the payment experience in their app. And that gives people more ways to pay. So if you're buying something with somebody in that app, you can split it, you can share it inside the Venmo experience. And we're doing more and more of that. So everything we're thinking about this year and over the next few years is, what are all the places where we think the experience could benefit from what is unique about Venmo and apply the Venmo experience to that payment opportunity or that commerce opportunity to give people more opportunities and more ways to use Venmo.
So banking, what about banking?
So banking in terms of, we don't think of ourselves as a, like instead of banking or in any relationship to the bank, I think there's a part of this which is as you give people more ways to use Venmo, they're going to want to, we think about the in and the out. So right now Venmo is you can send and receive money. More of the stuff we're doing this year is about sending or buying or paying. Then you go, okay, well then you end up in a place where, well, how do I get more money into it, right? And so you can think about, we're exploring some things where you have more of those services about how to get money into it, how do you get cash out of it, and doing different things like that. Not necessarily to replace your bank, but to give you more opportunities and more flexibility with how you get money into and out of Venmo. So that's definitely something that we're thinking about over the long term.
You are part of a larger company. Ultimately, Braintree, PayPal. And usually larger companies do not innovate as well. How do you keep your team in a discrete way, mathematically discrete way, isolated in order to innovate?
We build a wall.
Ah.
Too soon? Is that too soon?
You're not, okay, it's over now.
Part of it is just alignment with the strategic vision with leadership in the company. So when you think about, for us, PayPal, Dan Schulman's our CEO, Bill Reddy was the CEO of Braintree when we got acquired, is now the COO of PayPal, and the rest of the executive team and the board is, one, do we believe in what Venmo's doing? Do we believe in what Braintree's doing, or Zoom, or Paydiant, or any of the other acquisitions that PayPal has made? And do we want that to be a standalone mission and vision in terms of the team and the product and the customer base? And these are not incompatible with each other if you're deliberate about it. And so, but I think it starts with that sort of leadership. And then it's a passionate and almost irrational commitment to what that vision and passion is. And the problem that I think a lot of companies have with their acquisitions is, no matter how much they want it from the top, if there's a big company there, the big one ends up swallowing the little one just from like inertia and momentum and sheer force. So it just takes that much more effort and commitment to whatever that vision is and that passion is to make it stick. And I think that's what we've done with Venmo, and that's what we continue to do. And we get the support, and what you see is we're able to, so we take this view of, it's not our job to tell our customers how to engage with PayPal as a company, PayPal Inc. It's not like, hey, use Venmo for this, use PayPal for this, use Zoom for this. It's, we want to meet you where you want to engage with our services. And if that's on a phone, in a social context, maybe Venmo is the right thing for you. A lot of our users have both services, and that's okay by us. We actually like that, because in some ways, you know, I use PayPal for one thing, I use Venmo for another thing. They don't, and it also gives you the freedom to not force one to be like the other, and allow them to have their own personality and identity. It just takes a lot of effort.
So actually, you don't build a wall. You build many doors and you open them.
Yeah, bridges, doors, and handshakes. Then,
so how do you make money?
How do we make money as a company?
Mm-hmm.
So PayPal, one of the biggest portion of the business is around merchant commerce. So when you buy something from a merchant pays a fee. What Venmo has done is take an approach of, this is a marathon, like ultra marathon we're in. I mean, even with PayPal, you think about it, the portion of PayPal is one of the biggest companies in this space, one of the biggest companies in the world, period. And they're just scratching the surface of like the total market. And then Venmo's one layer below that. So we're in the first inning of the game, or the first mile of the marathon. What it's about is to build the consumer base, teach that consumer behavior. When we started, people weren't using their phone to pay for things. People weren't comfortable with plugging their bank information into a phone or using an app. And we took the approach of, rather than build the opportunities to pay for things, which a lot of people did, a lot of companies went after, like, hey, go tap your phone somewhere. We said, let's think about the easiest and best way to create trust, which is the foundation of everything we do, trust among the players in the network. So when you send money back and forth to each other, trust with us as a platform and a service, and get it to a point where we have enough trust and enough critical mass to be able to go do things that are interesting. We're there, but that started with building the consumer base and not worrying about things like monetization of it as much as what is the long-term experience we're creating. When we start now connecting a massive and fast-growing consumer base with commerce opportunities, with merchant opportunities, and a bunch of other things we're exploring that, because of the unique aspect of Venmo, don't necessarily have to follow that traditional sort of payment processing path. That's what now starts to create the sort of business opportunities for us over the next 3-5 years.
Let's go back. Let's open the floor for questions, and I'll keep coming back and forth. Why don't you start? You're our leader. You
All right.
have the questions that have been submitted online. Pick one.
All right. Well, we have a really good one here from Emily, and she asks, how do you think confidentiality will work with electronic transactions in the future?
It's a tricky space, and Venmo in particular. We've selected a business where you bring together all of some of the most complex issues facing business today in terms of mobile, electronic, finance and commerce, and social, and bringing all those together. And how do you navigate that? One of the things that people love the most about Venmo is the social sharing piece of it. One of the things that's most important to people in terms of their finances and social identity is privacy and confidentiality. Yeah. And how do you get both? You know, if you asked somebody 5 years ago, they'd say, you can't. You never have that. You would never have a payment platform with sharing or social. And now we've proven that there's a need for it. People want it. It's a constant challenge of how do you balance that. For us, privacy, confidentiality, security, knowing that you can trust the system and the user that you're paying and sending and receiving to is absolutely most important and has to come first. But we're definitely sort of blazing new trails and there aren't, textbooks for how to do this stuff. So it's something that we think about a lot, talk about a lot, and one of the biggest challenges we have going forward is how do we make sure we keep what people love about something like Venmo, but continue to open doors and push the envelope in terms of ways to use Venmo that take advantage of that without jeopardizing things like confidentiality and privacy.
That's interesting because the notion of privacy is relative. You know, different generations have different approaches, but also to privacy, but also culturally speaking, we see differences across countries. And you're thinking about going on a global scale and expanding that. You know, have you looked at other payment forms and, whether they are rooted to their cultures and how can you go there on a global level and keeping the same experience?
Yeah, I think one of the reasons we're still US only is we wanted to put more puzzle pieces in place. That's how I kind of talk about it, is we wanted to make sure we had something that we knew was a complete package. So in the US, as we built it, because we started as a startup, this has been this long gradual curve, and now we're adding different pieces. When you get outside the US, you get very fragmented regulatory environments, cultural environments, and perceptions of what is acceptable from a privacy standpoint and sharing standpoint. And each of those you got to tackle independently. And so we're being pretty thoughtful, and we get challenged a lot about, when are you coming to this country? When are you coming to this market? Why can't I use it there? I want Venmo in this market. And trust me, I want to get to all those markets. We've been very deliberate and thoughtful about making sure we're ready to go do that, and it's at the right time in terms of what we've built with our product here, but we're prepared to go into those markets. One of the benefits of, you asked about being a smaller business inside this bigger company, one of the great benefits of being part of PayPal is there's a lot of that they've encountered, the good and the bad of it. They've had a lot of success, made a lot of mistakes, and all of it has made them better and one of the most successful and broadly, broadest coverage in terms of countries, markets, and currencies that have tackled all of those same issues, that when we go to do that, we get the benefit of all those learnings. Whether it's from a privacy standpoint, regulatory standpoint, cultural standpoint, currencies, language, risk is a big one in terms of protecting our users and the company. And mm-hmm. So we can piggyback on a lot of those learnings in the infrastructure they have to allow us to focus on what we're doing, but and benefit from the stuff they've already built and learned about.
Let's take one more question from the web. And also, if you want to ask a question, we have mics here. We have a couple of mics. So please raise your hand in advance. So can I see the hands here? Yes, so you see them, and you see them on this side. Go ahead.
All right, so another question from the Facebook live stream. This is from Dan. What was the hardest part of building trust with your first few customers, considering money and bank account information is so sensitive?
Well, the first few customers were Ikram and Cortina's friends, so that was easy. That was one of the hardest things. It's so as viral and as popular as Venmo has gotten today, it's it was that equally that hard and more at the beginning, right? How do you get that initial seed going so you can build that momentum? And as anyone who uses Venmo knows, you probably joined Venmo because one of your friends was on Venmo and they kept badgering you about, you got to get on Venmo, I got to pay me back on Venmo. And so there was a little bit of it was baked in because of the way it started to catch on was we just needed enough people who felt really passionate about it and trusted it to get that ball rolling. And the challenge was, what if you get on Venmo and you don't see any of your friends on it or anyone you know on it, then you automatically can't trust it. We very early days, we implemented this idea of how do you provide social proof even if you don't have your friends on it? And so we implemented what we call the public feed. And the design around that in the very beginning was, what happens if somebody downloads Venmo, connects their contacts, and then doesn't have any friends on it? Then we're going to lose them. The public feed was there to say, well, I don't know those people, but they sound like me. If I see people paying their babysitter, then I know to pay my babysitter. Or if I see people splitting drinks, then I know I can split drinks. And we created this idea of social proof. That beginning phase of the first few hundred, first few thousand was really, really hard. You'd sit there and you'd look at it and you'd be like, one new user, two new users. Yeah. And you had to get over that hump. And it's real world relationships. The interesting thing about Venmo compared to other social networks, and people use Venmo like a social network because it is, Venmo is your most intimate relationships. Where are you spending money? You can't, Facebook, you post things and your friends from high school see it. Instagram or Twitter, you follow people that are celebrities or whatever you do with it. Venmo, when you're spending money with people, you can't fake it. And so you have your most intimate relationship. And so that was this challenge of how do you connect somebody who doesn't have their network on there yet and make them feel welcome and at home. Once we got over that hump, then it just kind of took on a life of its own. And the fact that people you trust already used it, and then we continued to maintain that trust and earn it and keep it every day that you used it was the answer. But there was a lot of, you know, a lot of long nights talking about how do you get that first ounce of trust from that first batch of users.
So how do you spend your long nights now? Worrying about what?
Worrying about, oh, geez. Things hit Venmo that you couldn't even have dreamed of in those early days. But the cool thing about Venmo is we enable things. We don't have to tell people how to use it. They figure out ways to use it and how to use it. We think about how do you support the massive growth? How do you protect from risk and things like fraud in these challenges that you never dreamed would be hitting you? Yeah. How do you continue to give the users that experience that they know and love? That's what keeps us up at night.
So who has the mic here?
Oh, and a secret about questions, the people with the microphones have t-shirts, so everyone who asks a good question, or everyone who asks any question.
I got a t-shirt, thank you.
Okay.
You mentioned before the regulatory environment and fraud, so is that starting to be a focus, and which regulators are looking over you now? Is the Federal Reserve looking at you, because you're not a bank?
It would probably be a shorter list of which regulators don't look over us.
Yes.
So very clearly, not starting to become a focus. It is always been a focus of regulatory and risk. And a lot of regulatory is around protecting our users. A lot of it's around things that protect the country. When you think about things like OFAC and FinCEN, there's federal, there's state level. Guidelines. Like I said, you have consumer protection, which is super important to us just because we love our customers. But when you think about the regulatory aspects of consumer protection, privacy, but it's one of the things that makes it hard to innovate in this space, honestly. But it is also one of those things that becomes, for us, a competitive advantage in terms of if you do that really well, and you provide a great customer experience. Those two things in this industry, typically people think they're mutually exclusive or incompatible with each other. We don't think so. We think you can do your job on all those fronts and make a great customer experience at the same time. It just is really hard to do sometimes because of the nature of the business, but it is in everything we do, it's part of it, and we're thinking about it.
Do we have a mic here on this side?
Hi, Michael. Thanks for giving your talk. I'm actually here visiting from the Netherlands, and in the Netherlands, there's a big movement on local currencies. So I'm wondering, what is the potential for supporting the online space for local currencies? Because here in the US, there are quite a few community currencies, that's called here, like the Berkshires and the Ithacash. So what are your ideas on that?
So I think what I hope to see for Venmo is to make it interface with, like I said earlier, wherever our customers want to be and want to use and how they want to use it. So I think our challenge is, just like we have a lot of pent-up frustration with people outside the US who have seen Venmo or heard about it or used it or yeah. saw their friends use it in the US and they get outside the US. You're talking about even a more localized version of that. Our job is to figure out how people, you know, where and how they want to have this experience and bring it to them. And so I think that's certainly something we're going to want to be thinking about. It's just, how do we get all of this done and get there as quickly as possible and do it in the right way? But definitely want to, you know, we don't want to tell people, don't use that, use this, or don't, you know, that's the wrong way to do it. We want to meet them where they want to be. So I think,
are you using Bitcoin or not yet?
So not in Venmo. Braintree has that, has an offering where they've baked it in to enable merchants to accept Bitcoin, on their merchant apps. But right now we're just straight U.S. dollars and English and U.S. people. So,
you know, when you look at on the global scene, is there any P2P that is ahead of you?
I think you could look at some of the apps in Asia that have sort of a different dynamic going on, where you have apps that become your gateway to everything, whether it's messaging or commerce. In the US and Europe and other markets, it's the other way around, where it's more narrow. You know, you don't want your app to do too much. You want it to do exactly what it does very well, and I'm fine having 100 apps on my phone. So I think you could look at some of the things going on in the Asian markets, where you'd say, in a lot of ways, just in mobile commerce in general, they've been ahead of us for a little while, but I think, you know, we see ourselves a little different than that. So I think we still have something that's unique when you bring together the mobile and social that hasn't been done before. But just in sheer volume, I don't think there's anybody keeping up with us right now.
Even in China, for instance, where you have this massive...
I'd say they're certainly bigger than we are right now.
Do we have a question here?
Hello.
Yes.
Hello. Recently, Bank of America, JP Morgan Chase, and all these banks...
Could you speak up and get the mic next to you? Yes.
JP Morgan, Bank of America, Chase, and all these banks have come up with this platform called Zelle, and they are trying to replicate Venmo with their banking apps. And how do you plan on competing with them?
I didn't hear that. When did that happen?
Yeah. Did you play a role in doing that?
It's on the news.
Maybe he did. Yeah. So we'll brief you at the at the end about that. But
yes, no. I mean, we look at the interesting thing is how many Venmo killers have come along, and everybody's chasing it. That same group of banks launched Clear Exchange 4 years ago, and I remember having a meeting with them, and we went to partner with them, and they didn't want to partner with us, and then here they are playing catch up. I think the reality is, people have their money in banks, and the banks have a service to provide. I don't think they're trying to be Venmo. I think what they're doing is trying to improve their service, which I think is a good thing. When these things come along and it gets people more comfortable with using their phone to send money and using digital payments in general, it's a good thing. When Apple Pay came along, it legitimized mobile payments for a lot of people who were uncomfortable with it prior to that, but because Apple did it, now they're comfortable with it. So when these things happen, we pay attention. They're potentially competitive. We don't think You know, we're not terribly threatened by what we see out there. We really just put our heads back down and focus on Venmo and focus on what we're doing. But I think overall, the industry is going to benefit from improvement. And if Venmo is a reason why the banks put together a program that makes it easier to send money, that's a good thing for people.
Go ahead.
In particular, what are your thoughts on like mobile payment platforms in the healthcare industry?
In
healthcare.
Yeah, a little more context of what do you...
So like specifically like the big issue that a lot of healthcare companies are facing are people are not necessarily paying out or finding easier ways to pay out, whether it be trying to dispute claims and such. Do you think like mobile payment platforms will kind of take over and kind of fill in that role of allowing patients to pay in an easier form?
Yeah, I mean, I think one of the things that we talk about connected, things being connected when we talk about Venmo, I think the more connected things are, the simpler they are, the faster they are, the better it is for everybody. And so if you, the closer you get to the moment in time, right? Think about Venmo. When you ask your friend to pay you back on Venmo while you're sitting at the table and you already paid the check, they're more likely to pay you back than if you wait a week and you're like, hey, by the way, you owe me $20. And they're like, yeah, I'll get it to you. Like, that's a little version of what people are doing, you know, in that context where they're, you know, they're having trouble paying their bills or following through on it. So I think the more that you can do to make that real time and connect it to the event or the experience, the better it's going to be and the simpler it's going to be.
We have hands here. Who has the mic now? Do we have somebody with a mic? Go ahead.
Hi, Michael. So I did my third co-op at a bank in the anti-fraud group. And so I was just wondering what your thoughts are on in terms of the competing forces that are providing clients the most efficient money means to transfer money between one another, that is without limits, upper limits, and also keeping your mind on the fraud considerations of those transactions. So you have someone that wants to transfer 10 grand, but they can't do it on Venmo, so they're going to move to a different platform. What are your thoughts on balancing the fraud and the convenience?
I think the size of the limit and the fraud are probably two different questions that are, they might be related. The size of the payment is really about, Venmo is a specific purpose. And if you want to send that much money, don't use Venmo. That's not what it's for. And we didn't build it for that. We can't protect you in that. We don't want you using it for that, and you shouldn't use it for that. Maybe someday, you know, we have a service to do that. So I think that's part of that is like, we've been very good at Venmo about keeping the blinders on and knowing what we do well and knowing what we want to do and sticking to that, even though people ask us to let them send that kind of money and it's tempting to sort of open it up. One thing we were good about is staying focused. So I think that's the, you know, higher limit issue. I think in terms of just fraud in general and fighting fraud and protecting the security of the users and the money in the system, it is, it's a constant balancing act of how do you do this in a way where you protect the users, you protect the company, but you make it a good experience. And you don't want to assume everyone is a bad actor when only one out of, you know, 100,000 are, or whatever the numbers are, because you ruin the experience for everybody and they won't use it. Mm-hmm. But you can't assume everybody's a good actor when clearly they're not all good actors. And so one thing we've done at Venmo that is unique is, one, we have a lot more information than a lot of other companies do to fight this stuff. So when you think about being part of PayPal, we don't have to invent all this stuff on our own. We have ways to leverage what PayPal's done and bring the two together. We also have our own sort of proprietary systems that are reinventing what is traditionally done in this space that has helped us give people a lot more leeway with a lot less information than banks or some other platforms might have been able to do in the past, which is the key to us trusting them first and having them, you know, prove to us that we shouldn't, as opposed to the other way around, and being able to sort of tell the difference between the two. But it's just a constant cat and mouse game.
Mike, you mentioned a couple of times that you leverage PayPal, you leverage Braintree, et cetera. Do they take care of your infrastructure, for instance, cybersecurity? Do they do that for you, PayPal? Or do you have your own team?
It's a little both. And so we there's a lot of stuff that we build and maintain on our own. There's a lot of stuff where we jointly do it. There's some stuff where we access internal systems, almost like a service, where they have infrastructure where we don't need to rebuild it, and we can tap into it, both in terms of the technology, but also the people. And in the case of the people, it's been a huge benefit to us to be able to leverage both operationally and expertise of people that a small company that is 100 people wouldn't necessarily have the kind of expertise that PayPal has either developed or acquired in terms of human skills and knowledge over time, where we might need somebody with that skill set for a couple weeks on a project. You can't, you know, if you're a startup, you wouldn't go out and hire that person. You might not even be able to find that person, but we have that readily available. And that's part of building the bridges and building, you know, not the wall, but building the connection points to the different companies. And they learn from us, right? There's a lot of things going on at PayPal in terms of how they build and innovate, where they're turning back to us going, what can we learn from Venmo? What can we learn from Braintree or Zoom or Paydiant? That's part of why they acquired these companies, not just for the product and the team, but to continue to inject new blood so that PayPal is an innovative technology company 20 more years down the road, just like it, you know, was in the early days.
So they acquired you, but they kept you also separate and in some ways, in many ways. Do you see a time where you'll be completely incorporated, you, Braintree, Zoom, whatever?
So I think that now is what that looks like. We are not a separate entity. We are, not a separate company. We're a team within Venmo or within PayPal. And I think where we are now, we've been part of. We personally, Braintree and Venmo got acquired in the end of 2013. So it's already been 3+ years. And so where we are today, we think looks a lot like the future of how this plays out, where the brand is separate. There are separate cultures. Like in New York, we actually have a PayPal team on the 6th floor, the Venmo team on the 5th floor, a lot of interaction between the two, but also a lot of personality that is different between the two. And you can keep both. And so I think it's less about, you know, having a separate company or a separate team, and more about what is it about Venmo that's unique and how do you keep that going.
Is it more fun to be with Venmo or with Braintree? I'm talking to our students, because we have here three alums, correct? Three alumni. So it's a tough question. What? You cannot answer that. You don't need to answer. Let's move on.
We all know the answer.
Who has
Venmo's
the mic?
Venmo's the most fun.
Hi, Michael. So I look at Amazon, where they're trying to have experience where I can just walk into a store, grab something, and walk out, and have it automatically pay without pulling up my phone or anything like that. Do you see Venmo moving into a space like that, or trying to enable things like that in the future, or just staying more with the peer-to-peer type?
I think that's awesome, by the way. And I think I'll go back to, like, we're not trying to solve those problems. And what I would say about that is, if that problem gets solved, is there an opportunity there where the unique aspects of Venmo can enhance that experience? And so I think that's how we think about it. It goes back to the experience. We're not going to go out and try to solve POS. We're not reinventing that wheel. We're thinking about, well, if that's happening, how do we make Venmo, you know, is there an opportunity where Venmo can enhance that experience? I bet there is, and how do we plug into that? And I think the thing about that is, it allows us to have a much broader reach and really focus on what we think is unique about Venmo and create more opportunity rather than sort of chasing down those, you know, those different sort of hardware and physical world applications.
Did you get your T-shirt?
I'm hoping for one.
Okay. Yeah, go ahead. It's your turn now.
All right.
Another one from the web.
Yeah, another one
can
from Facebook.
Can we send
Live.
The people who asked questions through the
yes.
web, can we send them
yes.
a T-shirt?
You should. Get their...
So give him four.
Get.
Give him one. No, that's fine.
Get their
fine.
Name and address. We'll send it out.
Yeah.
All right. We have a question from Jonathan on the Facebook live stream as well. And
His question is, in terms of the primary or the secondary focus of Venmo being the social aspect, does Venmo have any plans to expand this social networking aspect and expand upon what it does already?
Yeah, I think we think about that, and there's a lot we want to do there as well. And it goes back to we don't think of ourselves as like a transaction engine or a payment engine. We think of ourselves as an experience. And I told this story to the team yesterday. It goes so deep into who we are in our DNA that in our database, like the guys and ladies who wrote the code, who wrote the tables, don't call it a transaction. They call it a payment story. And the story is what's going on around whatever that payment is. And we have a mission statement where we say we want to connect the world and empower people through payments. And so part of that is everything going around the experience and what would enhance that. And so we think a lot about enhancing that social experience and a lot of the new things we want to do that we're not talking about yet, but that we're certainly thinking about internally are not necessarily tied to the traditional merchant payment volume business. It's more about tapping into that other half of it and thinking about how we build that out and enhance it.
I have a sort of follow-up question to the social media side of it. So I was wondering if you had specific kinds of users that you were looking for, because it does affect how people interact with the platform. As more friends get it, it changes it, but also when my mom downloaded it the other day, it changed how I now interact with the platform in my experience.
Yeah.
So
how did it change? In one word. One word.
More conscious of what kinds of payments and the messages.
Yeah.
Seven words. Got it. Got it. Got it. Okay, the messages. That's the main thing. Absolutely. I saw that. Yes. You want to?
I mean, it is. It's interesting because that's sort of the social side.
On this side.
Like, if Venmo's cool today, we don't want it to be uncool tomorrow, right? And so how we handle that is important because we want you to keep using it. We also want your mom to use it and use it in different ways maybe. We hear a lot of stories where Venmo has actually been a connection point to bridge generation gaps where the college student, the kids go away to college and the parents get on Venmo as a way to connect with their kids to send them money rather than wiring to their bank account. They use it as an opportunity to send a nice note and along with the money. So everybody's happy.
And to track what they are doing, how many pizzas they had. Okay, here on this side.
Thank you. I was curious what your opinion is on the development of blockchain technology and how it might impact your business in the future.
Yeah, so I think this goes back to we're not placing bets on it one way or another. I think there's a lot of stuff going on there, and nobody's real sure how. There's a lot of opinions about how that's going to play out. When you think about our merchant business, like on the PayPal and Braintree side, their job is to enable whatever way people want to pay and their merchants want to accept forms of payment, we want to meet them there. Venmo is going to be the same thing. If we get to the point where we feel like Venmo has an opportunity to sort of tap into that and make that part of the experience, we will. It's not something we spend a lot of time thinking about today. It's not a huge focus for us today, but it is something we certainly, keep an eye on as we think about where it's headed down the road.
Do we have the mic on this side? Yes,
hi.
And then you.
I was wondering, I know there were a lot of early day payment apps that weren't as successful that focused on smaller features like how you actually split payments, as in how much is one person paying versus another, and more additional features that Venmo doesn't have. Are you guys looking to integrate that now that you have a wider spread of people using Venmo, or are you afraid of kind of feature creep and looking to keep a relatively simple platform?
Yeah, that's an easy one. It's the latter. Like we saw that happen, and we figured people could keep track of all that. There's other apps that you can keep track of that, and we definitely stay focused on the core experience and not trying to solve. Once you start trying to solve different use cases like that, like split the pizza or split the trip or split the gift, then you start getting a very bloated experience. And I think one of the things, I'll say it again, simple, simple, simple. It's much harder, so much harder to make something simple than it is to make it complicated. And so we are obsessive about keeping the simplicity of it. And part of that is sometimes not doing things in the product that sound interesting, with the focus being simplicity first.
Go ahead.
Thank you very much. So putting the pieces together, you mentioned people hold money on their banks and you empower them through their payment experience. As you continue to expand and leverage PayPal's globalization or global presence, are you thinking about empowering people through the payment experience that do not hold money in the bank?
Yes, absolutely. I mean, that's a big push for PayPal Inc. globally. And it kind of goes back to the, it shouldn't be so hard to use your money or store your money or get at your money. It shouldn't be as expensive as it is. It shouldn't be as hard as it is. And for too many people in the world, that's still the case. And in the US alone, there's a range of estimates, but tens of millions of people that are unbanked and underbanked. And when you look at something like M-Pesa in Kenya, that basically leapfrogged the entire, you know, evolution of the last 50 years and just went to straight to, all right, text people money and there you go. I think that's Venmo is not necessarily starting there, but I think what we're doing with Venmo and with PayPal more broadly will get us there, where this should, we talk about the democratization of payments, and you should be able to break down those barriers. And if we do this right, it should naturally happen.
Did he get the T-shirt? You know, I have to work for you now, I mean, because I think that you what you have in mind is to start something like that elsewhere. In Latin America? Good. Now, you know, you heard it here. So I think at the end you have to come to Mike and see whether you can start working together on globalizing Venmo. Don't do it on your own. Anyway, any question? We have time for two more questions.
Hi, Michael. I want to circle back to like cybersecurity that Joe mentioned earlier. We know that banks are, you know, security is on top agenda for all the banks, and then they have spent a lot of money on security and they have suffered really bad breaches. So can you just tell us a little bit on what initiative that Venmo or PayPal has been doing on the security space to secure everybody's money?
Yeah, I mean, we're fighting that same fight. I can't tell you exactly what we're doing, you know, we think about, you know, access to the system, protecting their money, protecting the user, protecting their identity. And there's dozens of touch points that you got to think about in terms of how people can defraud a system or a network. And we have to look at sort of all those access points and all those touch points to be able to protect against that. So it's a broad-based effort that thinks of, you know, up and down the stack of technology across all touch points of access to the account, to the system, to the network, to your databases. You're fighting, a multi front war on that stuff that touches all parts of the company.
Who has the mic on this side? You have the last question. I know that you want to raise questions. Mike is ready to stay here till tomorrow morning with you, because he brought many T-shirts. He has many T-shirts, so you'll each get one. Yes, go ahead.
Hi, Michael. First of all, I love Venmo, so thank you and the team for that. So there's a lot of talk regarding the future of money, talking about becoming a cashless society. So there's a growing concern about what's called the war on cash. India is seeing gotten rid of its highest denomination currency. The euro and the dollar are talking about the same thing, which would take away for the US dollar over 70% of hard currency, in the name of, you know, fighting fraud, et cetera, which I think is, you know, going in the right direction, or trying to. But there are some concerns that this direction of moving into entirely digital transactions, that the financial institutions and the government will essentially have dictatorial power over, you know, the lives and the privacy of private citizens. I was wondering if you had any thoughts or comment on that.
Could you repeat that question?
That's a long one. So what about focusing on a cashless society?
I'll say this again. We're not trying to replace cash. We're not trying to replace the wallet. We're just trying to make it a better experience. And in fact, thinking about how do you make it easier to get money into and back out of. And cash is not going away. Cards are not going away. Phones aren't going away. Venmo ought to connect to all of those different points. We're not in the business of deciding whether cash should be here or not. We just know it's not going away. And so we think more about what's the right way and right point in time where we connect those two. Because right now, to get money out of Venmo, you got to move it to your bank and then go get your cash. Should we be giving you direct access to cash out of Venmo? Should we be giving you different ways to get money into Venmo? Less about replacing cash or wallet and more about just enhancing that experience and connecting you to all those different touch points.
So let me ask you a personal question. You know, when I look at your journey, you told me that you did programming, what was called programming then. Then you studied business. Why are you the CEO?
I think I found this little niche where I know how to speak technology, I know how to speak business and put the two together to build something. And so I build things. If you look at my career, different industry. I've been in payments for 6 years, but the first day I showed up with Ikram and Cortina, they slapped this thing on the desk and they're like, there's something called a money transmission license we're supposed to have and we don't. So can you help us figure out how to go get it? I was like, okay, I've never heard of that, but let me go figure it out. It's really all about building things. And I think technology enables things that weren't possible before. But there are very few people that can sort of put the two together. They're really good technologists. They're really good business people. I find myself sort of, straddling the fence in between the two, and I think it's a pretty powerful combination.
But you speak also experience. You say, it's not only business, it's not only tech, but the whole point that you made is that it's the experience that counts.
There is.
So you're adding this dimension too. When did you start learning about speaking experience, this new language? Relatively new language with Venmo.
The experience. I mean, it started.
Started from day one.
Yeah.
From day one.
Yeah.
That's interesting.
Remember that startup I told you we ran into the ground?
Yeah.
Every step of the way, you're learning things. I mean, I literally draw on experiences from. That was 20 years ago. I tell stories now. Every now and again, I'll be like, this reminds me of that day. And you draw on it. I mean, the successes, the failures, I think the failures stick with you because they have more acute pain feeling than the successes. You don't stop and like analyze your successes. So I think that's why people say you learn from your failures. But every step of the way, you're learning. But I think what I've learned, what I've proven, but also what I've learned is there are a lot of things you can learn. And for me, it's like you can build things in any industry. You can always learn the industry. But you can't learn how to build things necessarily. And so for me, it's been in different industries. It's, literally every step of the way has been a different, turn into a different industry. And I get into it, spend a few months, and all of a sudden I know as much as everybody else, and then you go start building things.
How many of you use Venmo? Raise your hand.
That's it?
It's almost everybody. What do you mean?
I saw a few that didn't.
Yeah, but they had T-shirts. They have to do it now. Mike, we're very glad to have you. Let me recognize also the three alums who came here. How long have you been with Venmo? Raise, sign language because sign language.
0 days with Venmo. Yeah,
yeah, but I mean, come on. How many?
All the same.
We wish we worked for Venmo.
Oh, okay. So if you want to apply to work for Venmo, I would like to ask you to come forward, take a picture with Mike, and then when you apply, you send this. Thank you very much.
And then you just say, Mike said I could have a job.
Yeah. Now, I know that you have dogs.
I do. Two golden retrievers.
And I know you're a runner. You told me that.
I did.
And what else do you do for fun?
A little bit of yoga, traveling, food.
And where do you like to travel?
We've done some international. We're on a kick right now back in the U.S. We're doing some national park.
Great.
Traveling.
So we have small things for you when you are playing with the dogs, when you're traveling, when you're running.
Nice.
All the above. And I got my Venmo T-shirt, too. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you very much. Great having you. So... Dear friends, Mike is here, not for the whole evening, obviously, but for those who want to ask questions, please feel free to come closer. And thank you very much for being here today. We have food, we have refreshment. Please enjoy the rest of the day. Thank you. This is great. Thank you.